This is Missy Lynx, and you're listening to the Indy Sports Car Podcast.
Welcome, ICP fans, to another episode of the Indy Sports Car Podcast. What's up to Hardy?
My blood alcohol level.
Okay. Frank Santoroski, what's up?
Hello, hello. See, I thought I'd imitate your wife since she's not here. How you guys doing tonight? Great to be on the show.
It's great to have you. And Richard Yadin, how are you, buddy?
I'm doing very good, thank you. Have everybody else enjoyed the Christmas holidays?
Well, did Santa bring everything you asked for?
I learned not to ask for anything, so I don't get disappointed.
That's how I live my life every day. Expect nothing, so everything I get is like, yeah, all right. So, that's positive thinking. All right. And Frank and Richard, they are hosts of a very fine show. Frank, you want to intro it real quick there? And
Richard and I appear on Drafting the Circus once a week. We're on our winter hiatus right now, but we'll be back up and going that towards the end of January, right around Rolex 24 time. But you can find us Drafting the Circus on the Hoobazoo Radio Network. You also find us on iTunes and on iHeartRadio.
And probably your favorite pocket wrap as well. And also a contributor, Chris and Frank, to Motorsports Tribune. So also check out their articles there, which I'll be pulling some stuff from you guys. Just read your Will Power review there, Chris. Good article, buddy.
Thanks.
I'll be posting that on our Twitter. You can find all that stuff at www.theindiesportscarpodcast.com. So, all right, there's everybody's plugs. Good, we got out of the way. All
right. Frank Linker, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. So, Chris is down in New Orleans with, I'm sure he brought his rubber head, horse head, right?
Nope, I did not.
Why not?
I didn't have enough space in the suitcase.
How do you not fit a rubber horse head? It folds millimeters.
Here's the thing. All right, here's why I couldn't bring it home. I had to bring home a book from my dad for Christmas, and I went to the Speedway's garage sale, and they had these ticket lanes from the 100th running of the 500 for sale for really cheap. When I told my dad the price, he said, give me 30 of them. So I got 30 of them for him. And, you know, surprisingly enough, when you get 30 ticket lanyards into your suitcase, they actually take up a decent amount of volume. So I didn't have the ability to pack all the stuff I wanted to pack.
Okay, so you traveled south to your parents with lanyards and left your clothes behind. That's weird.
I brought clothes with me. Don't get me wrong.
I don't think you'd class a rubber horse's head as clothing. Which, well, I hope you wouldn't, anyway.
No, he does. He does. That's what I mean.
If I was drunk, maybe.
Well, Richard, you haven't been in New Orleans, have you?
That's very true. No, that there is very, very true. Yeah. Point taken.
Yeah. Chris is a weird bird. but he's awesome. I just want to throw it out there. Richard came on a couple of weeks ago, and we had a great, awesome talk about F1. He used to work for Williams, among other things, and just really awesome that you guys would never hear, and we would never hear again, too, because my recorder stopped working. But this is actually Richard's second time on, so really happy you were able to come on tonight. Richard?
Yep, nice. Great to be back.
And, Frank needs no introduction. Everybody's a huge hit. Everybody loves Frank Santoroski when he comes on, because how can you not? He's an entertaining guy, so what can I say? So, again, gentlemen, let's do our 2017 roundtable discussion of what sucked and what was great. What do you say? Right on. All right.
What do we say?
Nothing,
what
apparently. Yeah, and there's some clapping, you know what I mean? Like, come on.
Frank Linker, everybody.
Woo!
You know, it's like a game show.
Hey, you know what?
Somebody's winning something at the end of the night.
It wouldn't cost too much for you to buy some canned music to throw in there. You know,
it's a spur of the moment, and you know, I was waiting for my $5,000 soundboard to come over, but Santa forgot me this year. Anyways, I just got to go with myself, man. I am my own soundboard. Trust me. And I'm better than the other somebody anyway. So, Chris.
Yep.
So, anything sports car related that comes to mind that was good or bad this year? Because I don't know.
Well, for good, obviously, we had the Rolex 24 at Daytona when you had, the Wayne Taylor Racing car finally, getting the victory overall. You had a great battle in GT Le Mans. Max Angelelli won, and of course the other guy, some guy named Jeff Gordon, he was there too.
Mm-hmm.
Did a good job.
Yeah.
The other thing, sports car related, that was pretty nice was the unpredictability that Le Mans this year had.
Fair enough.
With Toyota and Porsche, and
it's bittersweet watching Porsche go.
Yeah, we didn't think that every single LMP1 car was going to have an issue, but that's the way it turned out. And of course, I was at work actually listening to Radio Le Mans on my phone when the number one Porsche stopped coming into Turd Rouge with an engine failure. And, the guy, John Hindhaugh, couldn't believe it, because they weren't expecting this to fail, especially Porsche at Le Mans. And you had the Jackie Chan car actually leading overall. I think within the final hour, they were still leading. But
did you see that car like wiggle its way through a ladder? That was awesome.
That was an awesome, awesome weekend. not for Toyota though. It's a shame that they had so many things go wrong that really shouldn't have gone wrong. But that's Le Mans for you.
I don't even remember it, to be honest. A blank memory, to be honest.
Oh, and then the last thing for sports cars, sure, me, Petit Le Mans. They had Penske running there, and they qualified on pole, and then Elio, I think, started the race and was taken out, in the first, 30 minutes.
I boycotted that race, cars. By the way. I refused to watch it.
Why?
Because I was not going to watch Elio Castroneves race around Petit, okay? Sorry.
The other thing, sports car related, that I think would be pretty cool to talk about, two things. One, the Bathurst 1000 in Australia, they had a very interesting race where the majority of the race was underneath wet conditions. So that was cool to see. And then you had also the Nürburgring 24 Hours on Memorial Day weekend. I was actually watching the finish of that race while, everybody else was watching Monaco, and I can arguably say that I had the more entertaining race on.
Yeah. You can just go to any, go-kart track and, an F1 race is on right about now and say, yeah, it was better.
So what happened in this race was it was actually raining within the final hour, and the car that dominated earlier on in the race had a electronic malfunction, I think, within the last couple hours. And they were trying to go back up through the field, and they were making their final pit stop. Well, it started to rain on pit road.
What series is this, Nürburgring 24 Hour? I don't even know what you're talking about, dude.
It's, I don't think it's actually, hang on.
It's not WEC.
I think it's actually, I'm not sure if it's unsanctioned or if they have a,
Is it sanctioned with the Blanchimont series?
It might be. I'm trying to find it.
Well, that would go along with the Blank Spot Endurance series, yeah. Did you hear Nürburgring, though? I don't know. It's not WC, I know that much. Because that's WC is about the only sports car European series we actually kind of follow here. Chris, I don't want you to get too deep in there.
So I
don't need to hear about DTM, okay?
It's not DTM. So anyway, like I was saying, so the car that, they were making their final pit stop and it started to rain on pit road, they actually changed onto rain tires because they couldn't get the gas cap back on the car. And they're like, it's raining, let's just switch on the car that was leading that had problems later on in the going.
What class?
the top class. I don't know the names of the classes, Frank. I just know that the Nürburgring 24 Hours is on. I'll just watch it. Anyway, so anyway, like I was saying, you know, they put the rain tires on, and you were watching this car just slice and dice through these back markers in lower class cars, and it was going through the field like a hot knife through butter. It was going, you know, two wheels on the grass, making passes in some parts. It was amazing to watch.
Those tire engineers are crazy, huh?
You could say that.
Yeah, man.
But it's like, and it was all by accident. Right, you know, water. It was like, okay, we're in the pits. It's starting to rain harder. Let's just put rain tires on when we can't get the gas cap on. And boom, they ended up winning. And it was really, really fun to watch. The race is on YouTube. So
wouldn't it have been, you know, wouldn't they have failed tech afterwards with no gas cap?
Well, they got it on eventually. Nah. They got the gas cap on.
It's just you didn't mention that. He said, oh, fuck the gas cap. Put rain tires on. That's where I got all that story.
A failing technical inspection.
Did I just curse? I'm sorry.
Speaking of failing technical inspection, the car that finished, I think it was second in LMP2 at Le Mans this year, actually failed technical inspection because the team actually drilled a hole in the bodywork so that they could easily access the starter motor solenoid or something like that.
Tap it
to actually get the car started, and because that was a modification to the bodywork that was not allowed by the FIA, they were tossed out of the event, which is really sad.
Did they reinforce the hull at least?
Do what?
Never mind. you can't just drill a hole through the bottom under tray. I mean,
it was behind the roll hoop.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But if we were talking about sports cars, and I know you did mention it there briefly earlier, DTM, but I think it's worth mentioning very, very quickly that the Mercedes, you know, the decision to withdraw from DTM at the end of 2018.
Wow.
I mean, it's Mercedes and DTM are, you know, like peanut butter and jelly. You know, they've been together for, as long as the hills. And for them to turn around and say, oh, we're pulling out of DTM at the end of 2018 and we're moving all of our efforts from that particular group of engineers over to the Formula E series is sort of, I think that sort of, you know, it's a big shocking, you know, it's a big news to the, you know, DTM world. But also I think it shows like part of the shift within motorsport going over to that sort of the Formula E style racing, the hybrid electric vehicle series. And you know, sports like DTM and a lot of these sports cars have got to keep pace with advancing technology to keep the manufacturers interested and, you know, keep the sport going, really.
Yeah, I mean, you know, DTM's isn't it strictly German-based, you know, sports cars?
I don't know if that's part of the rule, but for, you know,
well,
as long
it's
as you
Deutsch
remember,
Touring
it's been...
Wagen Meisterschaft, so yeah, I would say it's
pretty much,
German.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like Honda pulling
and
out of IndyCar.
You know, to answer your earlier question about who sanctioned the 24 Hours of Nürburgring, it's the ADAC, which in English translates to General German Automobile Club. In German, it's Allemeister Deutscher Automobil Club e.V., but that's who sanctioned that. And this, actually, this event has been going on since 1911.
Oh, yeah, I mean,
I've
heard
Googling
of it, yeah.
Yeah, so.
I thought you knew that off the tip of your tongue there. I'm disappointed.
Oh, no.
That's what I meant. Like, that's what I was like, Chris, you got to give me a little bit more info here, dude. You're just kind of spitting out tracks and stuff. Like, I'm like, I don't know what he's talking about.
It's the Nürburgring, dude.
Are we supposed to research before the show?
Who, me? Or him? Or us?
No, any of us.
Well, Chris sort of kind of did. I don't know. No, not
okay,
really.
Speaking of research, there's an app that you all should download for your phones called QuizUp. And there's actually categories about IndyCar racing and things like that, and it's amazing. You can actually challenge each other.
I've done the quiz up IndyCar. I beat that level so many times.
I tried challenging you, Frank, and you didn't respond.
Oh, okay.
He said that with a little bit of hatred. Dude. He's bitter, Frank. You hurt his feelings.
It was about 2 o'clock on Christmas Day afternoon that he sent the challenge, but it's not like you've got anything else to do, is it?
I was going to say, I don't think I have quiz up on my phone, but you know, I'm going to download it, and I'm going to challenge you tomorrow, Chris. I'm going to challenge you
to the heck with tomorrow. I'm challenging you right now.
Oh!
I don't have
Chris
second,
with the haymaker. Frank, retort.
What, you don't have it on your phone anymore?
I don't think I have it right this second, yeah.
But oh, your phone's right next to you.
My phone's sitting on my knee, yeah. Convenient? I think Frank's scared. What do you think, Rich?
Lord, I'm not scared of
I would be. Have you ever listened to this man talk? I don't know what he's saying at the time. And I go, how do you know this? How do you know that name? Why do you know that name?
It's when Wikipedia references him rather than the other way around.
He's the most interesting man in motorsport.
And okay, and before we leave sports car quickly, I just want to huge congratulations to Pato O'Ward and James French. That's all I got to say.
Yes.
Domination like they should have, pretty much. Anyway, so all right, F1 world. Some things have come out, and it's a good thing we have an expert with Rich Yeon with us, so I'm very interested to talk about this. And Frank can't stop me. But, Frank, would you like to, start it off and give me your best and your let's start off with your best memory of F1 over the course of this year.
F1, my best memory. I want to say that they had some pretty good races. For Formula One, for me, the big disappointment was Ferrari.
Yeah.
They had come into this season so strong. They looked so good last year. Coming into, they were really going to take the fight to Mercedes, and they just fell flat. Some of it was driver error, some of it was the team letting the drivers down, but they were nowhere near Mercedes in performance, and we had another, one-horse show in Formula One. Mercedes week in and week out. Best story of Formula One, Hamilton's teammate, They signed this guy.
Valtteri Bottas, all right.
Yeah, they signed this guy after Nico just decides to bolt.
I can't believe. I still can't believe he did that. Wow.
Wow. Yeah. I mean,
can you imagine if Montana won that first Super Bowl? He's like, peace.
See ya. Yeah.
I like to make an argument that the best Formula One story actually had little to do with Formula One. I would argue that Alonso going to Indianapolis was the best Formula One story of the year.
But we can talk about that in our IndyCar segment. Yeah.
Yeah, fair point.
It's okay. Talking about it twice in one show, I'm all about it. Because, it's a proud moment for an IndyCar fan. Not for nothing. I was proud to be an IndyCar fan.
No, absolutely it is. I mean, it's like all three of us were at Indy. No, Frank, you weren't at Indy this year, were you?
I was supposed to be, but my mom came up from Florida, and I never get to see her.
Frank couldn't make it.
I'm so glad I did, because I spent 3.5 out of the 4 hours of her screaming at me how much of a freaking loser I am. So I'm really glad I
Oh, hell, we could have told you that.
I know. I get it enough from everyone else. Didn't need it from her, especially I sacrificed an Indy 500 for her. And that's a lot of sacrifice right there. If you guys know me.
Besides your marital problems aside,
my mother.
And we both of us got to sit in a couple of Alonso press conferences, and the dude
was a barber. Yep.
He's like the antithesis of the typical Formula One driver. When he came over to Indy, he just kind of melded with the culture of Indy, where you're a little bit more fan friendly, you're a little bit more media friendly, and he took in as much as he could.
He's loving it.
And then for his point, he enjoyed the experience, and he's still talking about it to this day, and so are we.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sorry, Chris.
Seriously. I think sort of piggybacking, not want to sort of distract too much from the Alonso story there, but to, look at the positives out of Formula One this year. I think Bernie Eccleston stepping down from, running the sport, I think is a good thing in the long term. I've got a lot of time for Bernie, and he's done a lot of very, very good things for Formula One, and, you know, he's made the sport what it is without any hesitation. However,
definitely,
the way he ran the sport, I think it was time for him to move on. I think it's time for new blood to come in. And I think Alonso's experience, you know, Indy is an eye-opener to him. And hopefully with his sort of seniority within the sport and within the driver, you know, council, for want of a word, better word, he can be the voice of, hey, look, you know, I've been over there. I've seen what it's like. This is how a sport should be run. And this is how we need to interact with the fans. This is how we need to engage with them and get them on board and make them realize that we are, you know, real people, and we're not some, you know, driver that sits in some sort of ivory tower and never talks to the real fans. You know, so hopefully that experience will feed back into Formula One and get, you know, the Liberty Group on board and work, you know, for positive in Formula One and help its public identity mellow out a little bit.
You know, that's interesting, and I kind of agree. I mean, do you think it will? You think they will? I mean, you think
I think they have to. I think they have to. I mean, everybody looks at Formula One, and everybody says, what's the negatives about Formula One? And it's the cost of going to the races in certain countries, the lack of action and lack of overtaking. Well, I think you've got, you know, now with guys like Ross Brawn involved in decision making and understanding how they can improve that, I think that'll help that side of it. But also, you know, having, you know, and the final sort of criticism of it is that it's too much of an exclusive club with the drivers, and, you know, the lack of interaction with the drivers and the teams, too much secrecy, there's not enough openness. And you look at what IndyCar do, and it's a breath of fresh air, really, for that. And I think that they could go a long way to help that and improve that side of the sport, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, we have no idea what an you do, I'm sure, but I don't know what an ERS system looks like, because every time a engine cowling gets ripped off or something, they blur the thing out.
Exactly.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah, so I think that... yeah, they do need to do something, and they do need to improve it. And I mean, Ross Brawn, you know, he's a smart guy, and some of the comments he's made, probably 75% of the parts on a Formula One car that teams will spend tens of millions of dollars developing and putting into practice every 2 weeks, they're standard parts that, you know, could be made common. And nobody would miss, no team would lose any performance on it. You wouldn't suddenly see a Sauber beating a Mercedes if you had a common component. But it would save huge amounts of money and potentially bring more people into the sport and reduce the cost of the sport, which is, I think, again, is a big aspect of it, and make the cars simpler.
So do away with, like, these more spec.
And I don't want to use the word spec, because
Why?
Part of it is
people think, because it's such a bad word. It's not.
Well, part of the
it can be.
Yeah,
to an extent.
Part of the
IndyCar spec, they're just fine.
Yeah, and
not
and
really.
Part of, well,
okay. they're on the uptrend, but when the exposure that the series needs. They need a lot more exposure, because if you go outside of Indianapolis, it's like a vacuum. And with the racing being as good as it is, it needs more eyeballs on it. But I digress.
It's getting it. We can argue about this soon, really, because we will.
But no. Going back to the comment on something being spec, is it a good thing or a bad thing? It depends. You get totally spec, but I think what you need to do is give teams the option of purchasing parts, common parts. Say, look, you know, and this is how NASCAR does it to a greater extent. You have a list of submitted parts which you can use for, you know, gearboxes and transmissions and the like. So there'll be half a dozen, you know, gearboxes and transmission combinations that you can use out there. And it's up to the teams to pick which one they want. And I think that could potentially be one of the ways to go. Or look at another thing that NASCAR does. NASCAR will turn around and say, hey, look, you can make whatever you want in terms of gearbox or whatever you want in terms of transmission. You can turn around to a team, a Gibbs, a Hendrick, a Penske, a Ganassi, one of the big teams, and turn around and say, look, If you want to go out there and build a rear transmission, help yourself, guys. And we'll allow you to run whatever you want to run. The condition is you have to make it available to every other team. So they don't want teams getting performance advantage from certain parts, but they want to make it a viable option. And so it's not a standard part, but it's a spec part, maybe. I don't know. I'm trying to think of a way to phrase it, because, yeah, you know, Formula One right. is not a spec series.
No,
it never will be.
Far,
it never
far
can
from
be.
It. And that's always my argument, like, right about now, because whenever everybody says, like, well, I'd watch more IndyCar, but it's just so spec for me. And I'm like, well, okay, so then go over to Formula One, because it's working so well. I mean, IndyCar has been great for since 2012. The racing has been phenomenal, and it's more or
for
less
sure.
spec.
Yeah. I'd argue that the cost of regulation changes have made it more difficult to catch up to the front, because if you have the same sort of regulations
for
like a
IndyCar or F1, I'm sorry.
F1. If you have the same regulations for a 7 or 8 year block, that gap from the lowest to the highest will gradually over time diminish. It's when you have a massive shakeup in the rules. Like if you look
will
at
it diminish though? Will it diminish?
The lower teams
because
will figure
it
out.
Yeah, but you see then what happens is the bigger teams spend more and
more
money
and more
to find
money. Yeah.
The smaller
F1
loophole.
Needs
so
a
then
cap.
What you end up finding is you end up with a series where you basically end up with like a 2x2x2. You have the two Mercedes out the front, then the two Ferraris, then the two Red Bulls, then the two McLarens, or whatever it may be. Because
well, not McLaren.
As you remove,
yeah, because they'd be in the garage.
Well, the one McLaren last.
But as you remove the variables in motorsport, if you make the regulations too consistent, then what happens is the big teams start to saturate the performance game. If you suddenly turn around and say to Formula One teams, right, you've got to run a six-wheel car, it would be a complete random result because it would be, you know, there'd be so many unknowns to it. But then the bigger teams, what would happen is they'd start investing the money and they'd start, you know, picking off, for want of a better phrase, the low-hanging fruit in the technical regulations and say, okay, how, you know, suspension is one of the key things. Right, let's look at how you design suspension on a six-wheel car, and let's throw $10 million at that, whereas a Sauber could only throw $1 million at that. So pretty quickly, the big teams would start to catch up. So the concept of having frozen regulations, I think, actually makes it worse because you end up with the saturation of knowledge and the money starts to talk more than if you have, I'm not saying, you know, random regulations, but at least constantly trying to change the regulations. And I mean, you saw that with Braun. Braun suddenly came out with a championship winning car from a big regulation change. If you keep the regulations too consistent, you're not going to see that performance, that sort of sudden shift in performance from a team coming from midfield to winning championships.
Okay, fair enough. I mean, Frank, what do you think on what Rich has said?
You know what? I think that the golden age of Formula One is long gone.
Well, yeah.
You know, the
do they have a future? Is there a bright spot, or is it just, you know? I mean,
there can be. You know, is spec the way to go? It's hard to say because everyone.
How about a money cap?
Everyone that dislikes spec, right? Everyone that dislikes spec wants innovation, right? But the innovation calls for money, right? And money free flowing into racing is no longer.
Yes.
And that's a fact. You know, the tobacco money is gone. The manufacturer money still exists in Formula One.
Alcohol.
How much longer that's going to last, you know, we don't know. You know, the biggest innovation you're going to see in racing this day and age is in series like Formula E, where the manufacturers have something to gain by that at this point.
Yeah, a lot more broken pieces they can sell to them since they have two cars instead of one. I mean,
well, no. What I'm saying is technology that you're going to see in your road car.
I get it.
Down the line, right? And that's Formula E is kind of the wave of the future for the automobile industry, and that's why.
Now, see, but I would almost argue
so many manufacturers in Formula E, and. And it's a tough sell to get another manufacturer in IndyCar, and in Formula One, you've got these old time manufacturers, you know, like Ferrari, right? Ferrari, how many road cars does Ferrari sell a year, compared to say Ford, Chevrolet, General Motors, Renault? You know what I mean? They
I mean, I always, I mean, I have a Ferrari for every season, you know. So right now, my Ferrari's white. What?
What I'm saying,
you're
is
not rich.
The Formula One with their,
isn't everybody rich?
You know, the rules are not unlimited, but
we live
they're
in America.
They're not.
What happened? I'm kidding. Sorry,
you're killing these balls.
I know.
Balls,
but, yeah, that's what I was going for. I'm sorry.
I think Formula One with innovation, you know, in Colin Chapman years, and just, you know, getting a better car out there are long gone, and you're going to see the team with the most money at the front, and there's going to be haves and have-nots in Formula One. You're not going to see another season like we saw through the mid-'80s, where you had, you know, 10 different 11 drivers on the grid that could win on any given weekend. You're just not going to see it.
Unfortunately.
Unfortunately. Now, IndyCar, you'll see that because they've gone full spec.
Well, I wouldn't
say they're going full spec.
I mean, because there is two different manufacturers out there, so that does mix it up a little bit. And there are a lot, and with these new Aero kits coming out, I think that even pushes it further away from full spec, because there's going to be so many different, you know, variants that you're going to have to deal with, that it's not like everybody's going to be dead equal, you know?
I don't know, man. They're not going to be dead equal. Not like we saw in, you know, 2013, where the cars were so evenly matched. There's going to be a little difference,
or even like last year,
by who can figure this out the best. I think this, when we talk about IndyCar, I think what we really have here is a driver's package.
Exactly.
I mean, this is something that's going to favor the driver's talent, which,
and the fans, actually, because not only
the fans, yeah, yeah.
Drivers drive against each other.
Yeah, but this is the new package. IndyCar is going to really favor the driver and the, you know, the engineering crew. They can get the setup just right.
Right.
Even though the package is rather similar, the cars are going to be much harder to drive. Whereas Formula One, you know, this, like.
Well, did you hear what Hamilton had said? He said that this year.
Last I heard, he said that little boys shouldn't wear dresses, but.
No, they shouldn't. But what I'm saying is that
that was all over Twitter today. Just saying.
Why did he say that?
Because
his nephew dressed up.
His nephew got a princess dress, and his nephew was wearing a Cinderella dress who had a little wand, and he got on Twitter and decided to say, "Oh, look at this. Little boys shouldn't dress as little girls, or little boys shouldn't wear princess dresses," and of course now he's
anti-gay. Yeah.
At least his nephew had something.
Gender or whatever they call it now. He's all for.
Oh, get over yourselves!
I don't know. It's stupid, if you ask me.
It's ironic on Lewis Hamilton commenting on somebody with a little wand, isn't it? But anyway.
Oh my.
I don't get
it. Now, Richard, I thought you were the biggest Lewis Hamilton fan in the world.
Yeah. As a driver, there's not many people out there competing, but as a human being,
I respect him. Yeah, but yeah.
Yeah, as a human being, I think there's yeah.
But let's talk about Lewis for a second. We know Lewis can drive a car. Okay.
Drive the balls off it. Yep.
But Lewis has had pretty much the best equipment his entire Formula One career.
Well, not according to Lewis, not this year.
Except for a couple of years.
That year, the last year when he was at McLaren, and the year he switched to Mercedes.
No, he said that this year was the worst, hardest to drive car he's ever driven in his life.
And has Lewis ever been in a Marussia? You know, or you know what I mean?
He's never been sidelined until they scrape out 3 inches right below the pedals so you can fit.
Exactly.
Yeah, I had to deal with that.
But you've got top talent guys in cars. I mean, look at our friend Alexander Rossi, right? Can you imagine if his first ride in Formula One was not in that Marussia, but in a Ferrari
Manor.
Manor rather, yeah, which is
Yeah.
You know, right along the same level. Or the Mercedes car.
Yeah,
I mean, if his first ride was in a Mercedes car or in a Ferrari or in a Red Bull.
He'd at least have two wins this year.
Exactly, yeah. So, instead, you know, his greatest result in Formula 1 was, hey, I almost made the points. You know?
But so let me just hop on over to IndyCar where I can, you know, make a name for actually show my skills, you know, because we drive against drivers here. That's what I mean. It's like, you know, F1, you know, and that's why it was, like, so awesome with Alonso coming over, you know. And I think Alonso's really going to come over here full time because I think McLaren going to trying to go for the 500 this year? It's not official, I don't think, but.
They said they're not, haven't they? I think
last
they...
I heard was no.
No? Okay.
Not for 18, yeah. but maybe.
It's amazing they say that right after Alonso signed up for another year.
Well, I think that was,
I think that was part of the agreement, wasn't it? Next year, you know, I'm pretty sure Fernando was going to push for it again, I'm sure. And he put on a heck of a show this year, didn't he? Goodness, it was just awesome. And he did great. Like, I expected him to, okay, all flash and everything else, but then just teeter off, you know. But then he was, you know, he you can argue he could have won if the engine didn't let go. I'm sorry. You know, you could make a good argument for it.
He could have won, but, you know, as I look through the history of this thing, it's amazing how Formula One drivers can really warm up to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway. You know, despite the fact that ovals are for, you know, you gotta really have the balls to have the ovals and whatnot. But if you look at the history of Formula One drivers coming over to Indy, you talk about guys like Jim Clark coming over, right, winning the thing. Jackie Stewart coming over, nearly winning the thing, right? Graham Hill coming over, winning the thing, right? Guys with no full experience in their life. And then more recently, guys like Emerson Fittipaldi coming over, winning the thing. Emerson Fittipaldi, you would expect him to be a road course genius in IndyCar, right?
Yep.
He turned out to be an oval master.
Yeah. His first win was on
his
an
first
oval
win was
in IndyCar.
Michigan. His first win was at Michigan.
1985.
Nigel Mansell.
Yep. Yep.
Right, his first win was at Australia, but then he went on to hit all the rest of his IndyCar wins were on ovals.
It's weird. I mean,
it's weird, isn't it? Yeah.
I mean, did you ever think with the drivers that we have now? I mean, you know, like Will Powers, you know, his best finishes have been on ovals this year, you know, the past year. And it's like when was he ever good at ovals before? But I mean, Texas, I can't believe he survived that race. I mean, because he's the most unluckiest driver in the world, and he survived Texas, so I don't know how. But, Pocono was a great race. He just pretty much schooled everyone and taught them how to pretty much win, you know. And it was just amazing to watch. It was a lot of fun. But okay, so I asked Frank what his and that was a really good, you know, segue. And then Richard started going. Did you give your best memory of F1 yet?
Yeah, I think the best, not necessarily memory, but I think the best long term thing from F1 was the takeover by Liberty. I think the worst thing that happened this year, I'm going to say the worst thing was
Lewis Hamilton Vettel again.
No, Vettel at Baku.
That was second worst to me.
I just think what Vettel did at Baku, at the first time I saw it, I did defend him a little bit. But the more I think about it, you know, it was deliberate. It was petulant.
Did you say Vettel hit Hamilton?
Yes.
Yeah, that's my note. That's my worst of the year, too.
It's like that left a really, really sour mark in it. And then, you know, he tried to defend himself like, you know, the kid being caught with his hand in the candy jar. It's like, what am I doing wrong? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's like an offensive lineman.
Let's think about that for a minute.
Going,
you just,
oh, I didn't do anything.
Why are they giving me a penalty? What was that for? Let me just think about that for a minute, shall we? You know, it's like, come on.
Put a helmet on, there's some guy, instructor, saying, now, rule number one, you don't use this as a weapon. Rule number two, you know.
Yeah, exactly. So like, and, you know, that is... You know, no matter what these guys say or whatever they think, they are role models, and kids and, you know, people around the world look up to them. And they've got to take their jobs, you know, very, very seriously with a huge amount of responsibility. Not trying to get too political on everybody here, but it is. And, you know, Vettel forgot that for a while there. And I understand, you know, everybody's been in, you know, heat of a battle of some sport or whatever it may be. And, you know, at times your passions and emotions can get the better of you. But at the end of the day, he's earning more per weekend than I'll make in a career. And he's got to remember that.
All three of us combined, I would say, geez.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Okay, now let me ask you something. Do you think Hamilton really brake-checked him?
I think he probably did. Yeah, I think there's part... And this was actually, you know, Frank, we discussed this on the Drafting the Circuit show, you know, at the time. One of the things that I think Formula One could take away from NASCAR is the concept of a restart zone. I think you're going to see far more, you know, I'm going to say it was Baku last year in the, as it was then the GP2, now the F2 race, where, you know, there's a safety car. The safety car went in and then the leader becomes a safety car, like with halfway around the lap. And he restarted too soon and they actually caught and passed the safety car before the restart of the race. I think, have a restart zone, which would prevent any concept of a brake check or whatever phrase you want to use it. You know, it prevent that from happening. And I think that's something they should pick up and take, go forward with.
Definitely, I agree with you. What do you guys think about that? Chris, how about you? Start with you.
I was about to say that reminded me of Jacques Villeneuve at the 95 Indy 500 where he passed the pace car coming to the final restart. I actually did see that clip on YouTube on Facebook a couple of weeks ago. F1's restart procedure definitely needs to be changed. I actually remember them saying, hey, why don't we try standing restarts? I'm wondering when did that get tabled?
I was going to say, has that ever been a thing?
That was meant to come in this year and then everybody thought it was a stupid idea. And
has that ever happened?
No, it is.
No, they never did it.
The only thing that comes close to that is when they would red flag a race for like a very serious incident. They would re-line up the cars, and then they would run a second race, and they would score it on aggregate timing.
Yeah, they'd combine the times, wouldn't they? Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, when's the last time that happened? I mean, I'm thinking it was like...
It was in the 80s. I remember.
No, they did it in 94. No. They did it in 94 at Suzuka.
At Suzuka, yep.
And I think Damon Hill won, and he was like 10 seconds ahead of the second place car, but only won by half a second or something along those lines.
Yeah,
but yeah,
it was second on that.
Oh, I remember watching that. Michael Schumacher was
I actually just pulled up an article right now. That was actually written just last month. The last F1 race to Siren aggregate time was Suzuka in 1994.
Yep.
I'm still blown away by that, Nico.
It's amazing.
Rosberg,
I can't remember Suzuka what my wife said to me 5 minutes ago, but I can remember that.
I know. I was thinking of myself. You two were just really impressed the heck out of me. How about you, Frank?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I can remember a race in the 80s. Remember race in the 80s where I think it was Nelson Piquet actually finished second on the track, but first in the race on the aggregate time thing.
Are you like now competing with them two with knowledge that I can't believe you have?
No, well, I'm just old.
Who?
I'm just old. But I just remember I always thought that the aggregate time thing was ridiculous. They should just bunch up the cars like they do in American racing.
I agree.
And of course, now you have
because they did because we did have there was one race, and I think it was PK, if I'm not mistaken, finished second on the track, but first in the race because of the aggregate time thing, and it was less confusing for the spectators in the stands, right?
Sense.
You see Alan Prost cross the finish line, and it's now the PK won because Prost wasn't far enough ahead of him.
And that's why I love IndyCar, the simplicity and almost the stubbornness to not really change too much and stay the same. Because a race is a race, and whoever finishes first wins. There's really not much more to the rule book than that. I mean, when it comes to that, you know.
Whoever finishes first wins, unless you count. No, never mind. I'm not going to go there.
No, go ahead. Go there.
Oh, go there. I want to hear it.
Because I want you to go there.
Well,
I'm about to go there.
All right, it depends on who you ask. Won the 1981 Indy 500. Bobby Unser finished first on track. Mario Andretti was ruled as the winner the next day when USAC posted the official standings. And then there was a massive court battle. And then finally, sometime in late October of 81, they declared Bobby Unser won the race.
Yeah, I was outraged. I remember that.
I remember that one very well. I remember that my family and I were camping. I watched the race on a little black and white TV set.
Did you have rabbit ears?
Yes, rabbit ears. Yeah.
Where were you camping at?
In the Poconos.
Nice. Right,
close to where you live. Yeah, we had a campsite there, and the next morning, I mean, when they went off the air, they were doing all this commentary, right? It was like, and, you know, you're talking, you know, you're talking. Jackie Stewart was one of the lead commentators, and as well as who was the other guy, lead guy, Indy in the 80s. Jim McKay and Jackie Stewart. Yep, exactly. And then they went off the air, and they were like, "Say this might not hold up. This Bobby Unser win." And I walked all the way up, out of the campground, up to the corner to buy a newspaper the next day, and I still have that newspaper.
I'm not kidding.
I still have that newspaper that says Unser ousted, Andretti wins Indy 500.
No kidding.
No kidding, yep.
Well, so what was also interesting about that was that they did the commentary for the middle part of the race on a tape delay basis. The beginning of the race and the end of the race, they called it live and then they just edited it into the footage. The stuff in like the middle of the race, for most of it, they would piece together after the fact because the race back then was not shown on live TV. It was on tape delay.
It was shown in prime time.
Yeah, until 1986 was the first year they showed it live. Although, funny enough about 86 was that the race was rained out and was actually shown, you know, the following Saturday live. It wasn't until 1987 that the race was shown live on national TV on Sunday live.
Hmm.
Yep, and Chris,
fun fact.
I can tell you that the rain delay in 86. I was a freshman in college. I had I was going to watch the Indy 500 with all my buddies in the dorm room, in the TV lounge, and then it got rained out. And then the next week we were off for summer break, and I ended up watching the race at home. That's when Bobby Rahal won.
So that year, my dad made three trips to Indianapolis. He went up for pole day weekend. He did that every year in the 80s and for the first few years of the 90s. Then he went up there for the first race weekend with a few of his buddies from work. And
the glory years there.
It rained. Do what?
I said the glory years, huh? Early 90s and all?
Yep. Oh, yeah. Yep. So they went, and it rained miserably. And they left, and they were looking at the radar because, you know, back in the 80s, they still had pretty good radar. And it was, they're like, yeah, it's going to rain. And they just decided to head home the next day, right? So they were at a rest stop in Jackson, Mississippi, and they heard on the radio, the Indianapolis Motor Speedway has announced that the Indy 500 will be taking place this coming Saturday. So they're all like, you know, hey, y'all want to go? Yeah, we want to go. So they got all the stuff packed up on Friday, and they left straight from work on Friday and drove directly to the parking lot.
Right on.
They got there early in the morning, and they slept in their parking spot until the cannon went off at 6 a.m.
Who won that race?
Bobby Rahal. Frank
Rahal.
Just said that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
keep up with this man, yeah. So.
What's
sorry.
That?
Yeah,
keep up with this man.
Keep up with this, yeah.
No, I'm sorry. I was just because I started thinking about something else when he was talking about, because Chris, didn't you just have a similar story about you sleeping in the parking lot the day of the race?
So in 2016, I did that.
I went to the
Little 500 the night before the 500 in 2016. By the way, great event. Everyone should go to it at least once. Went there, covered it, and then went back to the hotel I was staying at with Joey Barnes, Matt Nix, Adam Tate, and Josh Farmer. And then I got to the hotel.
And Laura and I were staying in the room downstairs.
Yeah, y'all had the nice room. We had the room with five of us in one room.
No, all those rooms are shitty. There were no nice rooms in that building.
Well, compared to the one that we had, anyway. And so Joey and Josh were dressed up, and I'm like, "What the hell are y'all doing?" Because it was like 1:20 in the morning.
Like in suits?
No, they were in, you know, their normal clothes that they went to the track in.
Well, what were you, naked?
No, I was just I was wearing, you know, just the stuff that I had worn the previous day.
How much less can you be wearing than what you go to a track?
No, but usually you wear pajamas and stuff at 1:20 in the morning. They said, you know, take a shower, we're leaving. So
you
I had to take
pajamas.
At 1:20 in the morning, you would expect to. Anyway, so I went and took a shower, got dressed, and drove to the track. And it was 2:20 in the morning. We were pulling in the parking lot. I still have the selfie on my phone with me looking like a zombie. Slept in the car for 3 hours. And, of course, when I opened up the door at 5:55 in the morning, the car alarm goes off because Josh had locked me in the car.
Well, I mean, did he crack a window at least for you?
No. It was five. It was early in the morning, so there wasn't any like heat or anything like that. It was just, you know, an annoyance because, you know, his alarm going off, and I'm like, great, I don't need to deal with this. So that was fun.
Chris, I remember that well. I remember when you got to the media center, you looked fresh and wonderful. now
he never
looks
like
Laker,
that at a media center.
Laker.
Yes, sir.
You need to come to Indy 500 with us one time.
I'll be there this year. This year, we will definitely be there.
Sure, you will.
I think, Chris, you and I have done the last three together.
Yeah, 2014 was my first year with credentials, but I've been to the last 22.
Yeah, I've been to, God, since...
Frank, this is the first year I'll actually have IndyCar hard card credentials, so yes, I will be there because I plan on watching that race from the Pagoda, dude. I can't wait to see
it. It's not in the Pagoda.
I will make it. I don't care. I will get up into the Pagoda. I don't care. I want to watch one lap from the Pagoda. I don't care if they tell me to leave. I saw the lap. I'm fine. I win.
That's right. I always watch the race from turn four. I leave the media center. You know, right when they're doing all the Jim Nabors singing the stuff.
Not anymore. And, rest in peace.
Well, not anymore. Yep. But I leave the race, or I leave the media center, go over, say my goodbyes to Joey and Chris and Josh and all those guys. I watch from the same seats I've been watching from since 2003 in Turn 4, which is right where J.R. Hildebrand crashed right in front of me in 2011. Oh, and the bulk of the race from there when there's like 15 laps to go, sprint through the tunnel, you know, the late caution, I sprint through the tunnel, watch the end of the race from the media center, and then get right there in the press room to get catching interviews.
That's awesome. You
I've
did it right.
I've done that the last couple of years, yeah. So
you done it right, yep. I mean, the only one, the only 500 we made it to was the year right before that, where Elio and Ryan Hunter Ray were fighting, and you know, from our point of view, we were right where, you know, all the stands start, you know, stacking up against each other, like, right after turn four. So we were in the shade the whole time. I was in heaven because of that, because I hate the sun. So, but we could not tell who won because, you know, Ryan Hunter Ray and Elio was in that yellow Penske car, and I couldn't tell each other apart. We all thought Elio had won, so... But then when we heard it was Ryan Hunter Ray, we were like, aww.
Aww. That's so where we all, yeah. So everyone wants to see Elio wins that fourth. And Elio, man, pushed out of a job this year, man. Talk about another disappointing story out of IndyCar.
Well, we will be able to say our goodbyes to him, I guess, this coming Indy 500.
Well, I don't know. I would doubt that this will be his last Indy 500.
No, but we didn't get a chance to say our goodbyes to him because nobody made it official till after the season.
Right, but I don't think we're saying goodbye to him yet, because I think he's going to race at Indy for years to come.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. I mean, he just won't be full-time in the season, yeah.
Which is still just not right, because how many poles did he get last year, Chris? Five, four?
I think he got three or four poles.
Yeah, because didn't Power edge him out by one?
Power edged out Elio by laps in lead, I think it was.
Oh, yeah, 443 to 444.
443 to 442.
Oh, that was so close. That was memory, too. I'm not looking at it.
Cashanova's had one pole. No, wait, three poles. No. Cashanova's had one win.
Yeah, one win. It was Iowa, right? Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, he, but both of us watched.
And his winless streak was 1,135 days.
There you go.
Yikes. Yeah.
Yeah. Send them to IMSA. Get them packing.
Get rid of that guy. Yeah.
How many? Don't feel bad. Get him out of here.
Don't feel bad. Clint Boyers is at 1,900 days.
I don't care. I don't care what he's at.
I follow Drunk Brian France on Twitter, and that's something he posts about every single day is Clint Boyer's winless streak in Sprint Cup. Or no, Monster Energy NASCAR Cup Series.
MENCS, yes, yeah.
I love that account for that one reason.
Podcast tonight. A lot of N-words being thown around. Kidding. Yeah, all right, so, all right, let's see. Okay, so anything else you guys want to touch on F1? Because since we really... I love how we keep jumping to IndyCar.
Yeah, we keep talking about IndyCar. Yeah. Anything else to jump on an F1? Yeah. Yeah. I would really love to see Robert Kubica in that Williams seat. Okay. That's just the Polish in me. I want to see my Polish guy back in a car. I mean, us Polish people have so few racing heroes and two of them.
They find the track on time.
Two of them are NASCAR guys, Alan Kowicki and Brad Keselowski. our third favorite guy.
What about Dylan Kwasniewski?
Who?
I mean, he's a legend. But
oh, I thought you made the name up, to be honest.
No, that's your real name, Dylan Kwasniewski.
Oh, okay. I just didn't hear. It just sounded like you made up a name with a ski at the end. Okay. I mean, Richard, did you understand what he said? It sounded like a mumble ski.
That's exactly what it was.
Man, you know what, Laker? I'm taking offense to you, man. You're offending my people.
No,
let's
I'm not.
Let's start all again.
I'm making fun of Chris's speech impediment.
No, but back to the topic at hand.
Hey, look, this all kicked off once about 70 years ago, and look where that goes.
Yeah, I really just like to see Robert.
Ouch,
Beck,
Richard, Robert Beck, with the burn of the evening.
I know.
Here we go. Sorry. Trivia, little trivia section here, and you can impress people that actually you probably wouldn't, because nobody else really knows me outside of this group. Juden is actually German for Jew, and we got the family name when.
I know that.
A group of people moved to the UK like hundreds of years ago, and they were filling out the immigration form, and they put their religion in the section where they were supposed to put their second name, and that's how we got the name Juden. Moving on.
That's cool.
Are
you indeed German? I mean, are you indeed Jewish?
No.
That's even more weird. Okay.
That is.
They wrote Jewish, yeah, when they weren't, so. Anyway, back to the racing topic. Yeah, I'd like to see Robert in the Williams car, and Richard, I mean, you've been with Williams, and we had this discussion off the air before we went live, but I want to go ahead and hash it again, because you've got some really great insights on how the Williams works and what we might expect out of this, so I'm going to throw it to you, and
yeah,
I'm not
I mean...
in charge of the show.
What happened?
I hijacked your show, Frank.
No, it's fine. You know, really, guys talk.
Historically,
I mean, I talk as is.
Historically, for the last 20, 30 years, Williams seems to have had a very strange recruitment process when it comes to selecting drivers and contracts. I mean, it goes sort of back to, you know, almost the early 90s when you had Nigel Mansell leave straight after winning a world championship on a contract dispute. Damon Hill left.
Greatest mustache in racing history, by the way.
It takes some beatings, doesn't it?
No, Graham Hill wins.
No, I'm sorry. Nigel Mansell had a great mustache. Great mustache.
Who else was? Oh, yeah, so then you had Damon Hill leaving again just after winning a championship because of some disagreement with Renault there. You know, the whole Jenson Button saga in the early 2000s.
What was the early Button saga?
Sorry?
What was the early Button saga?
So what there was an Williams? Area there where he was initially loaned to BAR. Okay. Initially he was loaned to Benetton after his first season at Williams, and then he was loaned to BAR. And then I'm trying to remember how it played out. After the first season on loan at BAR, he wanted to go back to Williams, but then they wouldn't let him, so he was forced to go back to BAR. And then at the end of that season, he wanted to stay at BAR, whereas Williams wanted him back, and he bought himself out of the contract, and it all got very, very messy. I was actually working for BAR at the time, and yeah, it was a very, very strange sort of scenario. I mean, one year Jensen was like wanting to be burnt at the stake, and then the next year he was the hero for wanting to stay. But the Williams have always had this sort of issue with selecting drivers, and they're not a top line team anymore. You know, they can't go out and pick an Alonso or a Hamilton or a Vettel up. They are sort of relying on the second best group, if you like, of drivers. And I think there's a potential there with Lance Stroll. I think he's got some ability. Whether he's the long-term face of the team, I'm not 100% certain on that, but
Stroll is.
Yeah, I don't know if he's the real deal, if he's really, championship material. Yeah,
there was an article that just came out today about it, and him talking about how he is certain that he silenced all his critics and proved that he belongs where he belongs, and he'll be there for a very long time.
I mean, he'll be there as long as his father's money's there, I think, is the basis of it. But I think he's certainly a competent driver and better than you or I. But
of course, and he did win a race this year.
He came third. He got on the podium at Baku.
Oh, I'm sorry. That is like winning a race in F1. I'm sorry.
Yeah, and for Williams, it was like winning a race anyway.
we used to call it the first place, third place. Yeah.
Yeah, and in all fairness, and to have, to be forced to sort of, obviously all the Williams plans changed last year when Bottas went over to Mercedes to replace Rosberg. But
I was like really surprised that it was Bottas. I don't know about anybody else, or if anybody else thought it would be somebody else, but it wasn't.
Well, it worked out perfectly for everybody involved there, really. I mean, Bottas had probably outgrown Williams a little bit there. He was never going to step up to the next level.
But let's be honest, it was the biggest, it was the most sought after vacant seat in racing last year,
But did you then look at the Mercedes hierarchy there? Obviously, they've got Lewis Hamilton as their star driver, and they could have probably gone to Alonso. They probably could have gone and got Vettel if they wanted. But, they'd just come off two or three years of real political angst, if you like, between Hamilton and Rosberg. And do you want that again? Do you really want to go through all that again? Or do you want to bring
Vettel
somebody
and
in?
Hamilton on the same team? That would be entertaining.
Yeah, exactly.
But not to Mercedes.
Yeah. And then, so, you look to bring in somebody who will say yes, sir, no, sir, when asked. At the end of the day,
That's what Ferrari did.
Well, yeah, but Toto Wolff is Valtteri Bottas's manager. So, I mean, that works out perfectly for them. And also, as part of the deal, Williams got heavily reduced Mercedes engine deal for at least 1 year, if not multiple years. So they get a nice compensation package with that, probably guaranteed to get one of the leading engine for a number of years going forward to keep them competitive. Because for Williams at the moment, pretty much the only thing that keeps them where they are in the pecking order is the engine. I think from an aero perspective, they struggle. So it worked out perfectly for everybody. And Williams have got to make the right call on a driver now. And I think where this all started, going back to picking a driver for them, that's probably still the hot story in Formula One for the remainder of the off season.
Who do you think should be?
I think if they pick Kubica, that shows ambition and a risk take, naturally, because it's a little bit of an unknown quantity. But arguably, he's as known as a lot of the other guys that are in the frame. I'm going to pronounce his name wrong here. Strokin, the Russian guy that's got the links with Renault. He tested in the young driver test at Abu Dhabi at the end of the year for Williams, and apparently was competitive and was quick. But it doesn't grab people's imagination. It doesn't go, wow, you know, let's look at how Williams are doing. It's like, oh, yeah, okay, they've got a young rich kid and a Russian guy is probably bringing some money. Okay, whereas if you put Kubrick in there, you guarantee that, you know, he'll be in the driver press conference in Australia. You know, there'll be you know, eyes on the team. There'll be people interested in what's going on there. And that's what a team like Williams has to do. They have to generate column inches in the press. And I think that's what they'll do. And I hope, my opinion is, I hope they go with that, because it'll show some ambition. It'll show, to a certain extent, a certain amount of risk-taking there. They've never really taken a risk. I mean, that they bought in, obviously, Valtteri, you know, he'd had the good junior series through GP3 and the like, but, you know, when they brought Massa in, that was a bit of a meh sort of move, you know, somebody at the end of his career, and he was going to do a solid job. He was never going to dig up any trees.
And to that point, when they brought Massa back after he had apparently retired, they said, well, now that, you know, Valtteri's going away, why don't you just come back for another year? It's like that move kind of surprised me. Why would you? You already done, walked away. Give us another year. You know what I mean? So,
and he did well. You know, goodness me, he did pretty well, and it was a good benchmark. He was a good benchmark for Lance Stroll. He gave him something to work to. He was a known quantity. He wasn't going to have an amazing weekend where he hooked it up perfectly. He wasn't going to have a terrible weekend where, you know, the car turned left when he wanted to go right.
Right, and you know, and for his point, Stroll wasn't as bad as we thought it was going to be either.
No, he struggled to start with the first three or four races. He looked a little bit out of his depth, and there was a bit of a, oh boy, but he did pick it up. And you've got he's probably the most prepared driver in Formula One, arguably since Hamilton, you know, 10 years ago plus now. You know, he's driven so many of those tracks in older machinery, admittedly, but from my understanding, in 2016, Williams basically ran a three-car team. You had two cars going to the race every other weekend, and then the third car going to all the tracks that they could get to every other week. And you know, he'd done so many miles in, okay, admittedly older machinery, but he got to learn the tracks, and I'm sure the car was set up to give as similar performance as possible to what the cars have had this year. So he was pretty well prepared there, and it was, you know, he's obviously got a long way to go still. I mean, he's still only young. What is he, 19, 20 now at most? And, you know, you look at some of the other kids of the, you know, the similar age, the Max Verstappens and some of the guys that are coming through Toro Rosso and the like. He's got to, you know, he's got to step up. And I think if they have Kubica there as a teammate next year, it'll push him. I don't think the other guys would.
good stuff, Richard.
Chris, who should have got the seat? What is this? What'd you send me?
Mark Plourd.
Mark Plourd, isn't he? Why does that name sound familiar all of a sudden?
Mark Plourd is a internet guy who.
I heard about this.
Yeah, he keeps the camp car site alive, and he's won. Was it seven championships, and his wife's won two?
Yeah, I mean, amazing,
right, yeah,
isn't he?
Yeah.
We should have him on the show. What a guy.
We should have him on the show. If we could find him, who he really is, we should have him on the show. That'd be funny just to talk to Mark Plourd, but no, he's not a real race car driver.
Yeah, no, I mean, I'll pretty much do pretty much anything, but no. I Missy was telling me about it, and I'm like, wait, what? He did what now? Okay, weird. Oh boy, that's funny, Frank.
He bought the rights to champcar.com and kept the old website alive when the series was dead. And
why?
Just,
I mean, it makes me hate him even more.
Because he lives his own fit. He's a cosplayer.
Exactly.
For lack of a better word, he's a cosplayer. Yeah, and he's a creative.
What's a cosplayer?
The guys that dress up in the
you dress as a
costume that go to like Comic Con or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh my God, those. Okay. Well, yeah, so Chris, you have no room to talk, dude.
He cosplays as a.
Five you go to football games as a horse.
Is this the mask? I'm not a furry, all right.
You might as well be.
I'm not.
You are hairy. Then you could put a... yeah, whatever. All right.
Thank you, everybody.
Frank, why you know that is disturbing, but...
I've seen him enough times naked. I mean, at the tracks.
But here's a topic. Here's a topic.
All right.
The 2018 Aero Kits and...
Yeah, let's get out of that one. Okay, that was it. Yep.
The disparity of the teams that are getting the test and the teams that are not able to test. Fair, okay. No fair. I mean, are these other guys getting an advantage?
No, I don't think so, because they're not going to be racing in the conditions that they're testing in.
Right, although there is no substitute for track time.
Will Power and Joseph Newgarden?
Well, I mean, the Andretti guys don't even have the kits yet, they do now. But
now, is that Honda's fault or is that IndyCar's fault?
That's IndyCar's fault.
Are all the Aero kits ready to go and to be ready to ship or what?
Because of the winter break, some teams aren't building, finishing up, finalizing their cars until like January.
I mean, Dale still doesn't know who his second driver is.
We're not talking about Dale. We're talking about like Andretti Autosport, right?
Okay, fair enough. Yeah.
So Penske has their cars on the track with the new kits.
At Sebring, about a week ago.
Exactly. Yes. And Andretti still doesn't have, as of that writing, didn't have their kits yet.
Okay. Well, as of right now, who has tested? You got Carpenter Racing. You got Penske.
Mm-hmm.
Foyt.
AJ Foyt, right?
Which, okay,
Schmidt Peterson.
Is everybody shaking? AJ Foyt got
right,
some.
Well, guess what? Andretti hasn't been able to test with the kit yet, nor has.
I'm sure if Andretti streamed enough, he would get it.
Ganassi's,
yeah.
No, Ganassi tested a little.
I was going to say, yeah, I think Ed
tested.
Dixon,
yeah.
Or, well, Dixon. Well, no, both of them were there, weren't they? Wasn't Dixon and Ed there? Or I thought I read that. Anyway. Yeah, it is weird that Andretti hasn't done it, but, I mean, do you think it was Andretti's call because he didn't want to do anything over the holidays, wait until January? Maybe he's thinking, I'll save some money because, I'll just hear what they found. And what they found is they don't know what to do.
No, it wasn't Andretti's call because they wanted a kit, and it was the other guy that was really vocal about not having the kit to test with was Bourdais.
Yeah, Bourdais.
Dale Coyne.
Okay.
I believe it was Marco and Bourdais going back and forth on Twitter said, yeah, this is great. These other guys are getting the test, and we might not see this thing till January.
I wonder if it's a Honda thing or if it's a. You sure it's not a Honda thing? It's very weird that it's all Hondas that are teams that are saying this.
It'd be interesting to see
Schmidt Peterson's got the kit.
It'd
be interesting to see how much sort of cross talk there is between the manufacturers there. I know in the NASCAR side of things, there's a lot of communication between the Chevy teams and the Ford teams and the Toyota teams, that they pool a lot of the information going on there. So potentially, I'm sure there's some of that going on in the background. Of wind tunnel time that's potentially paid for by the manufacturer rather than the individual teams to get at least a baseline. And these days, the simulation tools and the work that they do away from the track is so detailed and intense that they won't be a million miles away when they come to getting on the track. And I'm sure from a business perspective that the team owners and team managers have sat down and done, worked out all the numbers and looked at how far off the baseline they'll be if they do save, hundreds of thousands of dollars to go testing and, test as late as possible to get the maximum return on that. I'm sure there's a number there, and I'm sure they've been pretty smart with that, and I'm sure maybe the drivers don't agree, because obviously the drivers do what they want to do. They want to drive, but at the end of the day, they've also got to make the budget. They may turn around and say...
Let me throw this at it. These tests are not on the team's dime.
Okay.
Firestone's dime. Some of these tests are on Firestone's dime, and some of these tests are on the manufacturer's dime. So Chevy was granted a test. Firestone was granted a test. Honda was granted a test. And they picked only a couple guys to go ahead and do these preliminary tests.
Wonder what the basis was on picking. Or did the teams pay for it, maybe?
That's where the disparity is. You've got the Andretti team has been left out of the test.
Plenty of money.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, you know, and it's like, you got the Honda test, you got the Firestone test, you got the, we got to test some tires, we got to test this. But not everybody is invited to the show. And Foyt was not supposed to be invited to the show, but at the last minute, they went ahead and let them go ahead and test it. So I don't know. I don't know if it's good or bad for the sport. We've got a long off season. There's plenty of time for everyone to get some testing time in. But certain folks feel, and certain folks, especially from Andretti Autosport, feel like, hey, you're leaving us out of the dance. We don't even have these things on our car yet. We don't even have these in the shop yet. But then you talk about teams like Junkos.
They tested, didn't they?
And these guys haven't even.
Junkos don't have the car built yet 100%.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Well, and they still don't know if Kyle's going to go the full season yet, right? They haven't announced anything yet.
They only have four races now.
Four for Kyle, yeah.
Yeah, but they've only announced two out of the four from the last time I've heard.
Yeah, but he's got Kyle a month ago. He just doesn't know what the other two are.
Yeah, and if you guys want to hear that, just backlog a little bit there, and you'll see our show with Kyle Kaiser after he announced that. It was a good show.
I was on that show.
Oh, yeah, you are. That's right.
Yeah, it was. Kyle was a great guy to interview. Yeah, good dude. I love Kyle. I wish Kyle all the success in the world. And I wish Junko's team all the success in the world because those dudes belong in IndyCar, you know?
Yeah, definitely.
Hey, so let's talk about Carlin for a second.
Yeah,
has made
racing the comedian.
Huh?
Thank you, Frank. I said great stand-up comedian.
Yeah, George Carlin. Yeah, he was okay.
What? He was okay? He was okay?
A kid. He was a master of comedy.
Yes, he was.
But I'm talking about Carlin IndyCar team. It's coming into our
Trevor
next year,
which I am stoked about.
We got Charlie Kimball.
I'm glad he's here.
Charlie Kimball's actually a good friend of mine.
Is he?
Yeah, he's one of the few IndyCar drivers that will give me the time of day every time I like tweet him or text him.
Same here. I actually sat next to him at the IndyCar intro media dinner that they had back in early part of May. Really cool guy to actually talk to. Also a fan of Barroom Trivia.
He didn't trip you or anything, did you?
Okay. Next day, Chris, you and I need to take Charlie out to go play some trivia.
Perfect.
Charlie was on our show.
Take him into the woods. Never mind.
Charlie was on our show right before and then right after he won his first race. And the neat thing is...
And I was there for it, thankfully. Mid-Ohio.
Yep, Mid-Ohio, yep. 2013, yep. Yeah. The funny thing is, I wrote a story for Driver Circus. It's like, drivers you should keep your eye on. Charlie Kimball, right? Had him on the show, talked to him, and then next thing you know, the guy goes out and wins a race.
That is awesome, though. And you almost feel like, and it's because of me!
I said, Charlie... I gotta thank you because you made me look like a genius because I said you're gonna win a race this year and you did, and God darn it if the guy hadn't not delivered since.
I know the feeling, Frank. It happens a lot to me.
But man, I love Charlie to death, and I wish him the best with Carlin and Max as a teammate. What I wonder is, you know, all these engineers and whatnot that were displaced from Ganassi. I think it was like 48 people that were laid off from Ganassi.
I bet the vast majority ended up at Carlin.
That was a good question. Yeah.
How about Harding?
So is Charlie and Max to be working with some familiar people?
Yeah, I think so. I think Harding got his own people. I'm wondering, I don't know where
Now,
Harding got his people from.
well, Barnhart's there,
Yeah.
so they're good to go.
So is Little Al.
I know. But, and I'm so happy about it. I'll finally get to meet my childhood hero next year. I can't wait. I got to meet Paul Page the first time I ever went to Iowa, and now I'm going to get to meet Little Al. Oh, I'm happy
Man,
about it.
I've got the best Little Al story to tell you.
You told it, I think, the last time you're on, right? In the bar, right? You're playing Dar Song?
At the bar, yeah. He
Yeah.
sang karaoke with us. It's
I
like
know. We
the Lord
went
Bart
on for 20
yeah.
minutes about it because I was geeking out about that story. I was so jealous.
That was just the chance happening. Well, that bar was right down the street from Nazareth Speedway, yeah. But yeah, just a day I always remember. I just sitting in the bar with my buddy, and this guy walks in, Marlboro jacket. I'm like, "You're Al Unser Jr."
Oh yeah, and Nazareth was the first track I ever went to as a little kid. It was my first race ever.
God, I
Were they racing
Bobby Ray Hall
chariots?
won it. What?
So were they racing chariots?
Dogs. Racing dogs. Dude, I'm you're the same age as me, Chris. Jeez.
No, I'm definitely not.
Yes, you are. When
How old
were
are
you
you?
born?
How old are you, Frank?
34.
I'm 29.
Oh,
Wait,
what a jump.
which Frank are you asking?
Linker.
Okay, yeah. How old are you?
29, he said.
Okay.
I'm 34, he's 29. He's acting like he's a lot younger than me. We're the same
I
generation, idiot. I mean, you talk like you're 50 though, with all these names that you remember back from the 70s.
Well, I turned 50 this year, so
Oh, well, I mean, dude,
cheers to me.
50's the new 48, Frank. So,
All right, so I have to ask, Frank, did
And
you
that
get your AARP card in the mail yet?
Yeah, I did. Yes, I did.
Actually,
3 days before, I got the AARP thing and I threw it right in the trash.
Richard, aren't you like about 34, 35?
I'm 34, yeah.
See? Right. So, Chris, I mean, you have something to say to the old guy over here, Richard?
That's okay,
Richard's
we're
cool.
friends.
Yeah. As Gavin Free would say, he's absolutely top.
Okay. All right. Let's see. We'll just touch real quick on MRTI real fast. Biggest surprise in MRTI, all three series. We'll just treat it as a whole, either USF 2000, Pro Mazda, or Indy Lights. Anything that comes to your guys' mind, and we'll start with Richard. Anything that comes to your mind, negative, positive, or both?
Must admit, it's not something I've followed too closely, so I'm gonna give a pass on this one.
But next year, you really should, dude. And then,
I should.
at the end of next year, you're gonna have an answer,
I will
guaranteed.
do.
All right. And you just gotta follow Crystal Hardy. He writes plenty of articles about it, right? So, I mean, he's got a great Parker Thompson article that just came out, what, about a month ago, Chris?
Yeah, about 6 weeks ago, yeah.
Right on. So check it out. And where can I check that stuff out,
That's
Chris?
a, that article went to IndyCar.com, actually.
I know. That's why I was wanting to say, and congratulations, buddy. Always love to see our friend on IndyCar.com. So, Frank. MRTI, best, worst, both. What comes to mind?
Well, man, I was glad to see Kyle Kaiser win Indy Lights. And I'm glad to see that the not only did he win a scholarship, but he's also bringing a new team on board to the series. You know, because
Hear, hear.
we've seen the Indy Lights champion gets a little scholarship money. We've seen in the past, Ed Jones last year went to Coyne. The year before, or a couple years ago, Gabby Chavez went to Brian Herta
Oh
race.
boy,
Brian Herta,
yeah.
yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Spencer Pigot,
Spencer
Carpenter.
Pigot, yeah, went with Ray Hall for a couple of races and
Yep.
ended up picking up the rest of the season with Carpenter. But
And now has a full-time ride with them next year.
yes, he
Yep.
does. Yes,
he does. And by the way, if you want to hear about Spencer talk about that full-time ride, just backlog a couple little bit, and we had him on the whole show. Frank, were you on for that one, or was Chris, or?
Not you.
I don't remember.
Not I said the chicken.
No, I think it was just Missy, Christian, and I, so along with Spencer, so definitely check that out.
Yeah, but I think it's neat that the Indy Lights champion is also bringing, you know, the entire team into the series, and that's just great. You know, the series needs more teams, especially with a bigger team scaling down like Chip Ganassi. 4 cars last year, 2 cars this year.
But they dispersed to other teams, and we got other teams coming in. So it really kind of stayed the same, really.
Well, yeah, exactly. But, yeah, this is the, you know, brand-new team.
And then those
expand. Not a brand-new team. A very well-established team in lower.
Brand-new team for top tier.
Stepping up to the next level along with their driver, and that's exciting.
And they got a great driver waiting in the heels and the lights now. So.
Yep.
I mean, and hopefully Martin will also get a seat in the Indy Lights. I have no doubt that he will. With who remains to be seen. But I mean, if I had to, I would have really have to. Maybe Carlin. Who knows? I mean, does Cape have any?
No, Cape does not have any interest in doing Indy Lights.
I don't know. Understand why?
Probably the money thing.
Yeah, that could be it. but they should have plenty of it with all the championships they win in the other two.
The only sad thing about the Cape situation is that the team has won so much in USF 2000, but Pro Mazda, you know, they haven't cracked the driver's title yet, even though they've won.
Martin was devastated by Watkins Glen, man.
Oh, I saw the podium. I actually watched the second Watkins Glen race recently on YouTube. I rewatched it, and the look that he had on his face after the race was over was like, you know, someone just ran over his dog.
Dude, he was bawling his eyes out. Tell me about it. I mean, he was upset, man.
I mean,
he was very emotional. But yeah, I mean, you know, we watched both races with his family and all. That was oof.
Well, you look at the awards banquet that they had, right? So they had a check for Victor Franzoni of $790,300. That
cha-ching.
Yeah, I know. So that went to Victor, right? So you're looking at a thing to Anthony Martin. And Anthony Martin, his check that he got was, I'm pulling the number up right here, it was $25,000.
See, and this is what I was talking to, who was I talking to? What's his face in USF 2000?
That's a difference of $765,300.
Wow. I'm throwing a blank on his name. Anyway, Mazda is starting to really do good as far as attendance goes at the tracks during Saturdays. I mean, you know, Road America is packed. You know, the Indy GP for Mazda Road Indy is packed. I mean, Watkins Glen, it's a shame it was raining. It kept a lot of people out, even for the IndyCar race. But I mean, Mazda Road Indy has been getting a lot more, you know, coverage as far as live streaming goes and everything. I really think they need to start spreading the money around more to the second and third place finishers of the, you know what I mean? That's what I think.
Agreed. For my good and bags, I know you're getting ready to get to me next, I'm pretty sure. My good, the two champions in USF and Pro Mazda, Oliver Askew and Victor Franzoni. I was really happy to see Victor win the championship.
That was a great championship, by the way. Him and Martin, neck and neck, like all season.
I firmly believe that they needed each other to show the kind of drivers that they are. They learned so much battling against each other that they wouldn't have learned as much if one of the two wasn't over there.
I mean, and I've been saying that, you know, the Franzoni Martin, you know, battle, that's going to continue on into IndyCar. I really hope so.
I hope so too. And what's also,
yeah, it's been a lot of fun.
Well, so what's also great about Anthony Martin, or not Anthony Martin, Victor Franzoni, Victor did not have that drive, or he got called by Ricardo while Victor was in New Orleans working at a go-kart at the Supercars USA Pro Tour Winter Nationals. Victor got that call, and the deal was set up over the course of a few days, and they actually confirmed everything about 3 days before the season started.
Yeah, because we were caught off guard. We were like, wait, what? Who? Where? Mm-hmm. Wait, what?
And Victor never actually signed a contract to drive for Ricardo this year.
Really?
Yep, that's a true fact.
Like a handshake?
Kind of yep, deal? Exactly. It was entirely a handshake deal to drive for Ricardo, and that's what it took to win. It was just a handshake agreement. That's what got Victor Franzoni the deal to win the title.
Right on. Right on. Was there any bad that you can remember?
I mean, obviously, if you're watched Pro Mazda this year, the second race at Mid Ohio when you had Jeff Green spin in front of Anthony. You know, then so funny enough, a friend of mine watched the onboard of Jeff Green. Jeff honestly was just trying to get out the way. He was out to lunch on that on that whole deal, and I don't think he meant to do anything. But the way that Victor won the championship,
he had half a lap to do that, dude.
It was just the way that they caught him.
He wasn't racing for anything. He could have slowed down and pulled over at a good spot.
And he didn't have a good spot when they caught up to him. But anyway, like I was getting ready to say, Jeff Green, to his credit, when the series went to Gateway, he finished fifth, but was actually the third fastest car on track after Anthony and Victor. So he actually did a decent enough job on the oval out there at Gateway.
Was that have anything to do with blocking Martin from a win?
He wasn't trying to block. He was out. He was just slow.
I don't care what he was trying to do. He did.
It's not like he meant to
he
do that.
Well, he basically was the teetering point of Martin winning a championship.
Martin had, what was it, Gateway? He won the last race at Mid-Ohio. He had two races at Watkins Glen he could have won as well. What happened with Martin, close. That where he lost the championship, was it was bonus points, simply put. Yep. Not only that, but he also, you know, kind of had a few mistakes at Watkins Glen, because he continued after the checkered flag was over and after the final qualifying session, and he lost.
Yeah, I remember this. It was some crazy rule that he didn't even know he broke.
Well, no, he continued after the checkered flag. He did another lap after the checkered flag was done. That's why he lost two grid positions.
Yeah, he was totally confused, I think.
He didn't win as many poles as Victor. I think Victor edged him also on fastest laps.
That's also true.
So bonus points. I mean, some people will still argue about Santi with the Indy Lights title, but I keep pointing out, if you look at bonus points, that's where Santi lost the title to Ed Jones in 2016 in Indy Lights.
By the way, breaking news about Santi. He's about to have some breaking news.
Again?
So stay tuned. This guy is the king of...
He's got enough money for a 3-4 race deal.
Well, he hasn't announced it yet, but he put out an announcement that he's going to have an announcement again.
Yeah, well, I mean, we'll believe it when we see it.
He treats himself like a king, and he blows a trumpet. Doo, 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 doo. I'm coming, guys. Doo, 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 doo. I'm just hang on. I'll be there in a few weeks. Just keep a lookout. I'm like, what is he doing?
Well, you know, realistically, he could have enough funding to do three races in a coin car. The second coin car is still not, it's still up in the air, you know.
I don't think Dale Coyne is going to take pieces and here pieces of there. He's going to find.
He took Fulvio Blabio once.
Wow.
Well, yeah, but you know what? Honestly,
I remember playing with that as a kid.
To your point, Frank, I don't think Coyne is set on having a rotating cast of characters. I think he likes the consistency.
Yeah.
I think he's going
to get
somebody in that second car who's going to be there the whole year. And it could be, our Mexican friend.
Pato?
No, not Pato.
Esteban.
Esteban Gutierrez, yeah. Or it could be, RC Enerson is.
That's what I'm hoping.
Ederson has settled all his lawsuits with.
It wasn't RC. That was Neil. RC has no lawsuit and never had a lawsuit. It's Neil Ederson has a lawsuit with Sam, and they just settled today.
Well, yeah, but they settled all that. Well, okay, the Ederson family has settled a lawsuit with Sam, which maybe will open up that, I think Dale's going to put somebody consistently in that second car for the entire year. But then right, again,
I mean, but
then
the whole
again,
lawsuit, I don't think had anything to do with, Coyne not naming RC yet, I think they're just waiting for the new year.
I'm not trying to tie the two things together.
I'm
just saying that he's got this off his plate.
True.
And perhaps that, I think, Gutierrez is a smarter, smart bet right there to say who's going to be in that car.
He doesn't have any oval experience. I would never.
He had Gateway. No, he didn't have Gateway. He had Pocono and Iowa.
Right. Okay.
But you can't get different than that.
Did he have Iowa?
Yeah. Iowa was his very first oval race. Ed Jones actually drove him around in a passenger car a few days before the event.
He made absolutely no splash when he came here, didn't he? There was, really not much he did.
I don't know, but I'll tell you what. He actually, to his credit, I saw him right after the race. He actually really enjoyed himself, and I think it further gave credit to IndyCar on an oval that it's actually a lot of fun to drive. And
no, I mean, Rossi came here. Everybody was, Fernando, of course, everybody just flipped. Gutierrez came here, and I watched him walk out of his garage, down the paddock, and nobody cared.
Well,
I was just like, that's odd. He just raced a full season for Haas. I mean,
well, you look at his results in Formula One. I mean, he had 1 7th place finish in all of his results in Formula One.
And he was a launch pad for Alonso. Remember
that too.
That was crazy. Wasn't that the first race of the season? Wasn't that Australia?
Yeah, it was.
Wow.
I think, although I do think that Gutierrez did get a raw deal, especially with Sauber, because he's actually, in my opinion, one of the more talented guys from Mexico we've seen in the last, few years. Rossi raced against him quite a bit in Formula BMW and actually beat Esteban at the Formula BMW World Final, if my memory serves me right.
All the more reason for Coyne to sign RC.
Well, Coyne's got to sign somebody, but Dale's notorious for not signing guys till
Tibba.
day before St. Pete. But
that's fine because RC came into Mid Ohio and really turned some heads the year before. Just saying,
I'm just saying, there's precious few seats left, and several guys looking at him. So,
I was really hoping for Tristan, but now he signed with the team in GDI. So he'll be racing IMSA full time. So, happy for Tristan. That happened, I believe, last week, sometime. The end of last week, sometime. But I was really hoping Tristan was going to make his way back in IndyCar because everybody just kept talking about Tristan Valtay in Texas, right? I mean, it's still fresh on my mind.
On the Dale Coyne Racing theme, I'm going to go ahead and talk about an interview that I think every one of y'all should listen to. I talked about this before the show, but Craig Hampson, Sebastian Bourdais's engineer, he was on a show called Dinner with Racers, and he actually talked a lot about how the team this past year, how Dale has run it, and also how the deal with Bourdais crashes here at Indy. He still feels guilt about that, number one. And number two, the job that James did, a lot of people don't realize how good of a job James actually did in the car that year, going from 33rd all the way to actually leading the race at one point. So y'all should really check that thing out. It's really, really nice to hear him talk about all the sacrifices that Dale has had and all the how small the team is.
He had the worst luck the first half of that season. I felt bad for him.
Well, it was good, and then it was bad. When it was good, it was really good. And when it was bad, it was really, really bad.
Yeah, it was historically bad. Like, wow.
Because
does he have any cars left?
He won at St. Pete. He was second at Long Beach. And, of course, that was good. Then you go to Phoenix. You're taken out in the first turn. You go to Indianapolis, we all know what happened there. Texas, we know what happened there. I think they cut a tire at Gateway Testing and crashed another car. But, you know, when they
it
were...
It was a never-ending just, oh,
no, it was just
money.
It was just the black cloud of bad luck just would not go away.
Nope.
It's almost like they changed their name to Andretti.
Yeah, it's like... I know. I mean, unless you're at Indy, then Andretti's unstoppable, apparently.
You might not want to tell Michael that, or Marco.
Yeah, I was going to say, car owners, yes, drivers, no.
Yeah, the four most famous words at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway are, gentlemen, start your engines. The next four most famous words are, Mario is slowing down.
Oh, boy. The Andretti curse, right?
Well, Mario's not too awful cursed if you've seen his house.
No, yeah, exactly. Well, you know. I mean, if you see how he spends his spare time flying around a lake with this weird contraption. That's crazy.
Mario's done pretty okay for himself, as has his son Michael.
Yeah. Richard, do you have a good and a bad for the IndyCar season just passed?
I think they both... sort of occurred in the same weekend in the same race, probably the 500. I think Bourdais' crash, in some ways it was bad for the series because I think it took a great driver out of the series for the remainder of the season, but also it was a huge testament to the quality of the medical teams and the safety teams and the engineers that are involved in that series and all major motorsport series these days to make those cars as safe as they are and as protect the drivers as they did.
Same with Dixon.
Oh yeah, no, for sure.
Yep.
Fair enough.
Well, thankfully Scott could walk away with that with just a minor limp. I mean, Sebastian was a little bit more unlucky, but again, when you if you had that accident 10, 15 years ago, you'd be probably in a far worse situation.
You look at what the weekend Dixon had. I mean, you won the pole, then you get robbed at gunpoint at a Taco Bell. And apparently he called up Tony Kanaan about it, and he almost treated it like as if it was like a cut he got, doing something. Like, it was like, oh, yeah, this happened. Like, it was just completely matter-of-factly.
I had to bend over and tie my shoes. My laces came undone.
Yeah, kind of like that.
I know.
Oh yeah, I mean, Dixon's pretty low key when it comes to just like telling like it is. Yeah, so
I can see Oliver Askew acting like that. He's the same way.
Yeah,
talk about like good stuff for IndyCar. Sato winning the 500. Holy crap!
Great stuff.
Didn't someone predict that?
Yeah, somebody I know did. I can't remember who.
Joey Barnes.
No.
Who was it?
Me.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. Our last show of 2016. We said make a bold prediction for next year. I said if Takuma Sato signs with Andretti, he wins the Indy 500.
Wow, good call, Frank.
Yeah, but let's talk about Takuma going over to Ray Hall.
Yeah, so
I think that's a solid move for that team. You know, with the new Aero kits coming out, the one car team was not going to work for Ray Hall. They'll be so far behind the curve. So now they've got Takuma in there, who's veteran of the sport. They've got a little Honda money coming in, a little Panasonic money coming in. You may have to watch out for Ray Hall team this year. And again, that's another team who's not been allowed to test yet.
I know. Yeah, true. Very true.
That's the other guy that's saying, hey, man, we haven't had a test yet. But, I mean, I look at that lineup. Graham Rahal, golly, look at him at Detroit this year, sweeping both races.
He got more wins in 24 hours than Marco Andretti's had in his career.
Ah, you got a chance to say that again.
And David. Combined. No,
okay. Actually, match the career win total, so. But, yeah, I'd really be interested to watch Rahal this year. They've been the top Honda team since the AeroKit era. Now we're in the post-AeroKit era to the common AeroKit era. And I'd love to see how they progress and move forward, because the Rahal team has some top engineering guys on their staff, and both the drivers are proven, you know, between Sato and Graham.
And I just want to mention this new era coming up. I mean, it is still, you know, the same chassis, but it looks entirely different. It looks like an entirely different car. So, and for some reason on Twitter, it got picked back up again. That it's something Missy and I had said months back when they first announced it. I say they renamed the car to the JW18. So that's why I say hashtag JW18.
That's not a bad idea.
What do you guys think?
It's not a bad idea.
It's not a bad idea, but, Dan Weldon did all the testing on the GW12, which is why they named it after him.
No, I understand that.
But, yeah, it's like,
but this car has a raised, front windscreen now, and more safety features and everything, and the major difference is the windscreen. So, why? I mean, we don't know why. So, and it does look entirely different than the one that Dan Weldon was testing. Let's face it, it doesn't have the back bumpers anymore. It doesn't have all the the big flare ups and everything covering all the wheels. So. The wheels are exposed again and everything, so it looks like more of like a proper open wheel car, and it just looks all around different, really. I mean, if you put this year's car and next year's car side by side, and to somebody that's not really familiar with the sport, they wouldn't be able to tell. That's all I was going after. So it was just a thought that I came up a couple months ago, but for some reason in Twitter the last week or so, it's been starting to catch on a lot of. A lot of different, tweets, retweets, and posts and all. And it's about, 90-10 on the yes versus the no, So, and I don't know, Rich, what do you think?
I'm not sure. Sorry, I got distracted a little bit there. Sorry, can we just...
moving on.
The question was, Richard... renaming the chassis from the DW12 to the JW18 in honor of Justin Wilson.
I didn't say that. Not the chassis, the car.
The car.
I think sticking with the DW is the way to go. As I did catch a bit of it earlier with Dan having done all the development work on the car. I mean, it's terrible what happened to Justin, goodness me. But I think the input that Dan Weldon had in that vehicle, I think sort of is still being felt by all of the drivers, and I think it's an appropriate name for that vehicle.
Fair enough. Excuse me. And that's been the pretty much sentiment like across the board. Like, a lot of people are for it, but some people are against it. So it's just interesting. It's something that we brought up literally 2.5 months ago, and we haven't really talked about it since. And for some reason, it's been getting dredged back up again. I don't know how that happened, but it did. So that's why I brought it up. So, all right. Well, let's look ahead. I mean, is there anything else? Did I miss anybody with their good and their bad? Rich, did I get you for IndyCar, right?
Yeah, we were on Bourdais' accident.
Okay, fair enough. And Chris, did we get you?
For IndyCar, no. For Road to Indy, yes.
Okay, I'm sorry. So, okay.
IndyCar.
We got Frank, so okay.
IndyCar.
Well, I just want to make sure to get everybody.
Of course. I think, I'm going to go on Richard's theme, the good and the bad. I think would have to go for the same event, but for different reasons. The good, I would say, is Texas, because you had a lot of action on track. But the bad in that, they got so many cars were removed from accidents that it made the results like a lottery. But I mean, you had Harding Racing getting a top five finish there, so no complaints from me on getting a new team in the top five.
I was pretty happy at the end of it. Yep, it was a good race. Definitely. What was your bad, though? Everybody crashing?
Yeah, Sato crashing.
All the crashes that took place there, you know, you had so many. The Kanaan accident where he caused, like, the 5-7 car pileup, whatever.
And almost every other one after that.
Oh, well, by the way, I want to make sure that we're all very clear on something. This is all I think we all can agree on this. This is all excluding the obvious best good that everyone can come up with, which is Fernando Alonso running the Indy 500. I think we all can agree on that.
Yes, definitely. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Because I figured it would be stating the obvious, like everyone say, okay, it's going to be Alonso, it's going to be Alonso, it's going to be Alonso. So I think we all just kind of say, like, you know what? So not everyone's going to say Alonso. We all just said something entirely different from Alonso. Because that, I don't know how y'all found out, but I was on Twitter like very, very, very late, or I should say probably early in the morning. It was like 6 in the morning, and I happened to see on Twitter, you know, someone, a tweet about Alonso running at the 500 with McLaren. I look and I open up McLaren's website on my phone, and it shows it right there. And I'm thinking, you know, what the hell? This can't be real. Well, it was.
Yeah,
and it was right after April Fool's Day.
Yeah.
We all thought it was going to be an April Fool's joke. I remember Chris Guy talked to you that day.
Yeah.
Said, is this real? Is it real? Is it real? And it really was. And there he was.
Can y'all imagine if someone would have written an April Fool's Day article about Alonso running the 500 with Andretti, and what would have been like, you know, 11 days later, this article comes out and saying, yeah, Alonso is going to run the 500. Can you imagine like how that person would have felt?
I don't know, because I write the April Fool's articles every year, and mine haven't come true yet, so.
What was yours this year?
This year?
Penske double-double.
Penske double-double. Yep. Newgarden and Keselowski were both going to run the Indy 500 and the Coke 600.
You know what? I do remember that.
Yep. It was a good one, too, yeah.
That was good. I like that.
Unfortunately, I fell for it passed it around.
You fell for it?
I did. I passed it around. I passed it around the whole of the office. Oh my god! You see what's happening at? Yeah, no.
No, that absolutely plausible. Miller Lite was going to sponsor both cars.
I love it.
Jesus.
I love that. That's good.
That's funny, good Richard.
Okay, so I guess looking ahead, 2018. Who's going to be the first time winner that hasn't won yet this year?
Shout out to redundancy. First time winner that hasn't won yet. Amazing question, Frank.
Really speaks for the second, doesn't
okay,
it?
Okay, let's rewind here. Who will be the next first time winner?
Go.
Any series or what?
IndyCar, I'm thinking. Or
IndyCar. Just IndyCar, yeah.
Spencer Piggott.
Great pick.
All right. Chris, you get the next pick.
No. Hold on. Frank, by when? By what race?
Huh?
By what race this year will Spencer have won? Not what race will he win.
By round five.
Okay, so by Indy 500. Okay. So you're saying, like, from the Indy GP on to St. Pete, in between that span of races, he's going to win one of those.
Yeah.
Why you be so damn specific? Why can't I just say Spencer Piggott's going to win a race next year? He'll win a race before.
Because
he's
it's a podcast.
We aren't this specific on Frank's show. I'm going to say Ed Jones.
Oh, I'm going to say on.
Well, here's the thing. I don't want to say something that someone that Frank already said, number one. Number two, Spencer still hasn't driven on every single track in the championship. That's why I'm going with Ed Jones. I mean, Ed Jones finished third at Indy this year with a hole in the nose of his car. The kid can drive.
And he's in a Ganassi car.
Which, by the way, the only Ganassi driver that's won the last few years has been Scott Dixon. Kanaan's last win for the last win for anybody in Ganassi's equipment without Scott Dixon's name being on the car was Kanaan winning in 2014 at Fontana.
Right.
Wow, that's a great pull there, Chris, and a great explanation why. Okay, what race? You know, up to what race?
I'm gonna say by Toronto.
By Toronto, maybe one of the two Torontos, or
there's only one Toronto. Maybe.
Okay. Oh yeah, it's not a double. Why was I thinking Detroit? I'm sorry. There used to be though.
There used to be.
I think they should bring it back. And I say, you know, when the next car comes around, was that 2021 or whatever they're talking about, 22? They should really make it so they can do standing starts.
Agreed.
I did like that, but it's just the DW12 is not meant for it.
Sebastian didn't like it so much.
Oh, he wasn't rushing to for that move.
Ba-doom. You know, I felt bad for that because, you know, if who was it? EJ Visser nudged him over?
No, so, it was Mikhail Loschen that ran to the back of him, hence the rush.
No, I know that, but Mikhail Loschen had a clear path until EJ Visser nudged Saavedra over to the right in front of the Russian. If you watch it closely.
Well, Alushin was last on the grid. He should have seen, you know, what was going on, or his spotter should have told him.
Did you not just hear what I just said? It was like EJ Visser was like right in front of Alushin.
Visser wasn't even in the IndyCar series that year. Visser was out.
I'm sorry. Who was it? Was it No, Vitor Mira wasn't in that.
No, I'm looking at it right now.
Who's in the back? Yeah, I'm telling you, Alushin is not the first car to hit him.
I'm looking. Hang on.
Hinchcliffe, right?
No, it wasn't him.
No, I just thought I'd just piss you guys off and say that.
I was there. I watched it. I have a YouTube video of it. Trust me.
No, you're okay. So first of all, you're right. Alushin was not the first car to hit him.
Can I? Oh, thank
okay.
God, this is a recording.
So, right. It looks like it was.
I don't got the name right, but I know it happened.
Carlos Munoz hit him first. I have the video right here on my laptop. I'm looking at.
Yeah, because he hit him first, and it was right before Alushin got there. It's not like Alushin had plenty of time to move.
It looks like, Alushin was not forced into him. Alushin was just unsighted.
Yeah, but he would have missed him if nobody hit him.
No, Alushin would not have missed him at all. I'm looking at the shot right now from the from Turn 4 Oval. Looking back towards the back of the grid, there's no
way. He went all the way to the right next to the wall.
No, there was already a car there. I'm looking at the video right now.
Okay, well, you said I'm right. I'm going to edit this. Whatever you say now, I'm cutting out, and we're moving on. Okay,
right. So let's put it simply. You know what? Nobody would have hit Saavedra.
If Saavedra wouldn't have stalled.
Hit the gas and went.
Yeah, that's true. Very true. And that's why I'm saying, like, it did stir up some controversy, did stir up some excitement for it. However, the cars aren't meant to do it. So
they do it every time they come out of the pits. Come on.
Right. So
you remember Shane Champ car used to do standing starts?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Richard, I mean, you worked on F1. Can you kind of elaborate on how a DW12 is not built to do a standing start?
It should be. I mean, yeah, I guess it's in the transmission and differential and the rear of the car, but I mean, fundamentally, it's not going to be a million miles away. It's more driver, you know. Maybe the electronics would need to be looked at a little bit to sort of help with that side of things, but fundamentally,
I would just like to state: when's the last time an F1 race standing start? You know, they had to redo it or whatever. There was a crash because somebody didn't get off the line. When's the last time it happened?
Well, ask Ricardo Paletti.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Chris, you're a key historian. You know all about that, yeah.
Yep.
Point being is, how many standing starts were successful in IndyCar out of all of them? One?
Well, no. You know, Champ Car ran the whole 06 and 07 season with him, yeah. Or 07 season with him, yeah.
They started doing it at Portland, I think, was the first time they did a standing start in Champ Car.
Different car.
DP01, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
but you know what? What's your fascination with a standing start? I'm fine with a rolling start myself.
Honestly, there's a lot of places where a rolling start just isn't good. Long Beach is one of them. When IndyCar ran at Baltimore, that was not a good place for a rolling start at all.
No. Look what happened when IMSA tried to do it. Good God. I mean,
IMSA had the right idea in a sense because they didn't even use the chicane at the end of the lap before they did the start. IndyCar, they forced them to go through that chicane at the very end of the lap before you got to the start finish line, even when you're on the pace lap. If they wouldn't have done that, they would have actually have had a decent looking grid, you know, when they ran there. But unfortunately, they were hell bent on them running that chicane right before the start of the race, and it showed by having straggled out fields coming to the green.
Well, you know why that chicane was there. Remember when? Who was it? TK that got the throttle stuck and went flying?
Here's the thing. You don't need that chicane when you're coming to the green flag of the race.
Very true, but sports cars can go over that chicane. I don't think any cars could.
No, sports cars used the chicane during the race, but they didn't use the chicane when they were coming to the grid.
No, I'm saying I don't think an Indy car could really go over top of it.
No, they can't. They could. They couldn't.
That's why they couldn't do what you're trying to say they should have.
No, there was space to the left and to the right of it. I think they were just lazy in it.
Okay. Hey, I say bring it back because it was an air-conditioned paddock. I loved it. I was in heaven. I hate the heat. And it was hot that one day. One race, boy. All right. So, So everybody got their good and their good. Looking forward. Oh, I'm sorry. Frank said Piggott. Chris said,
Ed Jones.
And then we went off on a tangent.
Richard.
Richard?
I'm going to hopefully pronounce his name right here. Zach Veach?
Yes.
Andretti?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Zach Veach.
Great pick.
Could be Indy as well. You know, I mean, if there's Andretti cars getting themselves sorted at Indy again.
And he's very good there. He's a great oval racer. He should have won Iowa 2 years ago. I don't care what anybody says. Yeah.
In Indy Lights,
Yep. I mean, that was a great race. I mean, he held that middle line. Remember Chris, off the start? Nobody helped him out. Stayed on that middle line, and by the time they came back around, he was in the front. I can't believe he pulled that off without any help.
He did a good job. I didn't watch the race live. I watched it later on YouTube, but it was a great, great job that he did.
Yep. I was very impressed. So, definitely great pick, Richard. Great pick. By what part of the season do you think he'll win it by?
It could be the 500. That'll be my. If he's going to win one, I think it'll be there.
Right on. So you're all right. So let's jump into that and let's make that our out. And before we do that, I just want to thank you guys for coming on. Really, just once again, Frank and Richard. Where can they hear you guys at when you guys come back from hiatus, or go back and check out some of their old shows? They got some great special guests on from great other podcasts. And, drivers, too. Frank, Richard?
Where can you hear us? Oh, Drafting the Circuits? Just Google that. Yeah, Google Drafting the Circuits. We're on iTunes. We're on iHeartRadio. Find us on Facebook. Find us on Twitter. Drafting the Circuits. We'll be back up and running right before the Rolex 24.
Right on. And where can they find you guys personally on Twitter?
7G 1967.
Richard?
You don't even bother looking.
Okay,
exactly, yeah.
And, I think I created a Twitter handle to sign up to log in to win some contest once, but that's about it.
And did you win?
No.
And did you win the contest? See?
No, racket, me nor the racket. Other 50,000 people that entered probably didn't either.
And Chris, where can they find your stuff at, man?
IndyCar.com, Motorsports Tribune, and for stuff about Connor Daly, the Noblesville Daily Times. As for Twitter, at C. DeHardy, which is also my Instagram.
Fair enough. And you can also find some great articles from Frank Santoroski, or Roski, or Roski. Roski?
Santoroski, yeah.
Ah, I got it right. All right.
It's a hard, hard O on the second one, yeah.
I'm so used to getting Christian's last name wrong that, you know, I'm just used to getting last names wrong. So, I figured I was getting it wrong. All right, but I got it right. I'm proud of myself. But, yeah, definitely check them out at Motorsports Tribune. A great, great destination to get the up to your current racing news. So, all right. Richard, you said Zach Veach, Indy 500 champion next year, huh, buddy?
What do you think I'd get on that Vegas? I think I'd make a bit of money on that one, wouldn't I?
That would be great, man. So, I mean, I'd be happy about it. And
sometimes you can make a lot of money on IndyCar races. One guy bet a few pounds on Rossi winning the 516. Rossi was going at 80-1.
Yep.
Is that before X or after Brexit?
Oh.
This was 2016, so yeah, before.
Okay, good. Well, that was good for him. He got it right in there. All right. How about you, Chris?
What?
Your pick for the 500.
Oh. Well, I picked him once before because of the spacing of his win, so I'm going to say Elio Castroneves.
Ooh, I like it. I like it. His farewell that we actually get to give him. Right on, because he deserves it. That's what I say. I think Elio Castroneves deserves a hearty, good farewell from the fans. And what better
way
to do it than
winning
his fourth? He's gone full time. It's ridiculous that we didn't get a chance to send him off. Massa gets four of them. Saying. I get mad all the time. I got to stop doing this. I'm always yelling. Anyways, okay, good pick. I like it. I like it. Frank? Santoroski? Frank Santoroski.
Actually, I was going to pick Elio, but
he was brewing over there.
I was going to pick Elio.
Hardy,
but...
he's the bane of my existence.
Well, I mean, you know what? Chris and I can take the same pick, and that's okay. Because we're cool like that.
Nothing wrong with it.
But, I mean, since your show is a little more confrontational than ours, I'll have to. you know what? I really want to say Elio wins his fourth this year, just based on everything that's gone on. But I'm going to let Chris have that pick, and I'm going to say that Ryan Hunter-Reay takes his second.
Ooh, nice pick. I like it. I like it. Two Andretti's. All right.
two Andretti's. Chris picked Elio. That's a Penske.
I was talking about Richard over there.
Oh, that's right. You picked Elio. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Pardon me. I don't watch racing that much.
Well, it's okay. I mean, the show's confrontational, so.
It's late. It's late tonight, too, so.
Whatever you're going to say, I was going to find some way to beat you up about it. Apparently, I guess. Didn't really realize that
so,
before.
So, Mr. Laker, who do you like for the 500 this year? And don't say Will Power.
I'm not.
It's off the table.
The one race the man will never win is that. For some reason.
Watch, he's going to win the 500 now, and Frank's going to be oh, crap.
He will.
Honestly, with these new era kits, this season is going to be the most unpredictable season in IndyCar. I for a long time.
You sound like
long
Marshall
time.
Ooh.
No.
Don't you ever disrespect me like that again, sir.
It's done. It's out there.
The man is plus 200 pounds on me and about miles of hair on his freaking face.
All right, so who do you like?
You know he's strong on me.
Who do you like for the 500,
freaking,
Marshall?
Tell your story after you say your pick.
Okay. My pick. I'm going to go with Ed Jones.
All right. Good for you.
All right.
Ed Jones is a good car, pick.
Feeling good about himself, and he's a I'm telling you, talented driver. So there you go.
There you go.
So what's the story?
How he big dogged me out of just saying congrats to Oliver Askew in Victory Lane when it was just Missy and I, him and Ollie. That's it.
Tell it.
That's it.
That's really.
He kept looking over and kept interviewing Ollie. Ollie's looking at me like, what? He was asking him the most ridiculous questions. And then I forget her name right now, but the very nice lady for PR for Miles or any came and pulled Oliver away for the second time. Yeah, her. That's it. Diana, we got him. And we weren't trying to interview him. We already got the interview because we already know he's going to win. So, you know, plus he's been on the show 15 times. Marshall wasn't big dogging me at all, but he thought he was, which makes it funny, compared to what he said, only a month earlier. So,
which
making
was?
Fun of us that, oh, we spend our time in the kitty paddock.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He said this to Rob Howden, of all people, by the way.
Rob's a fantastic person. I mentioned Dinner with Racers earlier.
Rob's awesome.
I hope that he goes on that show. I really do.
Well, speaking of, Rob does have a great podcast that you guys should definitely check out.
He did a Road to Indy one for a couple episodes, but he hasn't done it recently because of time constraints, which I can understand. He's a very busy guy.
Yep, but when he does do one, they're always very good, and he's probably just waiting to get all, everybody to kind of get situated before he starts, talking about who's going to be racing next year, I'm sure.
Of course.
Yeah. And we'll definitely have him on, too, because we always have him on every year to go over, Miles Road Indy, a big Miles Road Indy show we always have on, and Rob Howden, we won't do the show without him, so, so we're going to kidnap him, if that's what it takes. So, all right. Oh, yeah, I picked it up. Okay. All right. That was a good show, guys. Thank you for coming on. I think, we'll definitely have to reconvene everybody back up. I'd say maybe about a month before the season starts, when all the chips fall, the rest of them anyway. And can't thank you guys enough for always coming on whenever you do. And, it means a lot to Missy and I, really. So thank you, guys.
Yay.
Appreciate it.
Yay. Have me back on any time. I love it. I love it, man.
Heck yeah, man. It's always a lot of fun. Always a lot of fun. And, Richard, we definitely have to get together again, man, and talk, F1 and F1 and some more F1. Yep. And make sure it records this time, and because that was a great show. And it just turned out to be a really great conversation, really.
It was. But that was good. Did enjoy it.
Yep. All right. So, and definitely, I always, always try to help them out as much as we possibly can. So if you haven't gotten it yet, please go to Amazon.com, guys. Check out Christian's book. It's my life and story.
Christian who?
The Outside. It's Christian, A-L-E-I-X-O.
Aliejo.
There you go. That's his last name, and his first name's Christian. Check out his book. Great book. I read it. I know. Can't believe it. I read a book. First time ever. It was a great book, by the way. And he got picked up to write another one, and the book is forwarded by Willie T. Ribbs. It's a great book. If you're a Kindle guy, you definitely want to get the paperback, but if you get the paperback, then the Kindle version drops down to 99 cents. So definitely, it's a win-win. So go check it out. Easiest way to get there, jump on Twitter. It's A-L-E-I-X-O Racing. So there you go. On that note, Chris, you want to take us out?
Nope.
Well, somebody's got to, because I'm not doing it.
I'll take us out, guys. You've been listening to the IndyCar Sports Car, the how do you call this shit?
Yeah, we don't take it out that way.
The Indy Sports Car broadcast.
No, whatever. Chris, you know what
See,
I'm talking about, right?
So don't have me take you out.
Okay, so I'm going to do it and just screw it up. Okay, so, all right, on that note, you know that I don't know, but Richard knows, Chris never knows, and Frank always knows.
Always knows.
No.
Yes.